Reading there in the very first verse. And look at the first seven verses here in Acts chapter 6. This is the first time, this is when we see deacons introduced to the very first church. And in those days, when the number of the disciples were multiplied, there arose a murmuring of the Grecians against the Hebrews because their widows were neglected in the daily ministration. Then the 12 called the multitudes of the disciples unto them and said, It is not reason that we should leave the word of God and serve tables. Wherefore, brethren, look ye out among you seven men of honest report, full of the Holy Ghost and wisdom, whom we may appoint over this business. But we will give ourselves continually to prayer and to the ministry of the word. And the saying pleased the whole multitude, and they chose Stephen, a man full of faith and of the Holy Ghost, and Philip, Prochorus, and Nicanor, and Timon, and Parmenas, and Nicholas, a proselyte of Antioch, whom they set before the apostles. And when they had prayed, they laid their hands on them. And the word of God increased, and the number of the disciples multiplied in Jerusalem greatly. And a great company of the priests were obedient to the faith. Let's go ahead and pray. Father in heaven, Lord, I love you. Lord, I thank you for your word. Lord, I ask your blessing upon our service tonight. Lord, we ask your blessing upon our church. Lord, we pray that this would be a help to us. It would strengthen us. It would strengthen our own personal walk with you, Lord. And Lord, we certainly need you. And Father, I do pray for the deacons of this church. Lord, I lift them up before you. Lord, I pray even tonight that we as a church and the deacons themselves would see the awesomeness of the responsibility that they have in this position within a local church. And Father, I pray that we just pray for your wisdom and your touch and have your favor and have your hand upon us and your leading and your guiding. Again, Lord, we love you and we pray to work tonight. I pray and ask all this in Christ's name. Amen. Again, tonight we're going to be adding another deacon to our church, and that is Brother Matt McDonald. He certainly has been faithful, you know, since I have been here. You name it, the ministry, they have been there, went above and beyond time and time and time and time again. And I have certainly appreciated the help that he has provided in the ministry here, the friendship provided. And anyhow, so tonight, what I want the church to see is how important this position is, all right, of that of a deacon of a local church. Many times today, it's nothing more than some type of oversight board or this, but that was never the intention in the Word of God. And so we're going to try and explore this tonight. In our text, the first churches basically experience growing problems. When a church grows, there certainly is going to be problems. That is to be expected. And this church was exploding, all right? There are probably close to 8,000 people now that are attending. Think of that, about 8,000. The church has absolutely exploded. The Lord is doing amazing stuff. However, problems are arising within the church. We have an example of it that is right here. And that is, you had the Grecian, or what's called the Hellenistic Jews, and the Hebrews. There was a dispute taking place amongst them. There were so many now. Of course, they were taking care of the widows that were in place. They would get food provided to them. And those now, the difference between these two groups went like this. Those that they're referring to Hebrew, those are ones that grew up right in Israel. They would speak Hebrew or the Aramaic, and then you had your Hellenistic Jews who come from outside Israel, Greek-speaking, a Greek culture, and so they're also there now. And so you have these two different almost cultures within the church right there, and a dispute was coming up. Those that were of the Hellenistic view viewed that their widows were not nearly getting the attention that the other ones were. And so this was also occupying the apostles' time in trying to settle disputes like this. They found themselves basically being firefighters and trying to put out different fires that were arising within the church. And so the apostles said, hold up, we got to have some wisdom here. And so they go before the church and said, listen, this is pulling from us where we need to be within the Word of God and in prayer. And they certainly recognized it was hurting their ability to minister as they should with their God-given responsibilities. And so that's when they said, you're going to look out men amongst yourself. And they give the requirements out. We're going to be looking at that are here in Acts chapter 6. And he said, let's find this group, all right? And then we're going to put them to handle a lot of these things that we have coming up right now. And so they did just that. They found them. I'll briefly mention some of those men. As we get into this message here tonight about the ones that we know about, we'll briefly talk about them. And then we see what the Lord did when they did this. All right? When they got this right and the apostles were able to concentrate on what they should be concentrating on, when they were settling the dispute and unity was coming back, and you see the work begin to multiply. It's not just addition now, it's multiplying now. And it starts with the Word of God was what increased first. That's not talking about people. All right, it's talking about what the apostles' primary responsibility was, and that is now growing. As a result of that, they're seeing a whole lot more converts that are taking place, including a series of tough converts, the priests from the temple. And so anyhow, we're going to look at that tonight. First, let's look at the growth problems that was taking place. The devil will always be looking for a way to attack the local church and hinder its mission. It's always going to be doing that. He tries to get it off course. In our text, we've already talked about it. We had the dispute come up between the Greek Jews, if you will, and the Hebrews. And this was no small issue. This wasn't something that was nothing. It could explode into something they did not want. They saw what was taking place and they knew we need to do something about this. The problem is pulling the apostles' time from where it should be, the Word of God and prayer. The problem is leading to division in the church. One thing the devil always tries to do is divide the church and discourage the leadership. That's what he was doing right here. He's trying to divide the church and discourage the leadership. It's a common tactic. He's used it since the very first church. All right? And the apostles recognize that's what's taking place. We're beginning to form two different segments here in our church based upon culture. And yet, again, what should be taking place is a new culture forming following the Lord Jesus Christ. And so again, the devil comes in, he tries to divide and discourage, and then on top of that, he uses distraction. And that's what's taking place here. The distraction, the leadership is distracted now from what they need to be concentrating on because of the different issues that are coming up in the local church. So you have this, this is what's taking place. And again, when there's growth, problems come with it. It goes with it. The idea then is not to avoid problems in life. You'll never accomplish anything if that's your goal. If you just want to avoid problems, you'll do nothing for the Lord and nothing with your life. What you do is you seek the wisdom from the Lord to get through those problems. And that's what they begin doing right here. Again, the answer is to find a way through the problems with the wisdom from the Lord and move forward. And that's what the apostles do here. They had misunderstandings with this growth taking place. I'm sure it was becoming more and more common, especially with two different cultures trying to come together. And all of a sudden, you've got 8,000 people in this thing. And really, it's just amazing how the Lord was keeping it together right now. And the Lord gives the apostles some wisdom here. He knew that they knew they were being distracted from what was most important, and that is the Word of God. Look at the conclusion of verse 2. When they go before the church and say, listen, we've got to do something about this, it is not reason that we should leave the Word of God and serve tables. And look at verse 4. He said, listen, when we're done with this, this is what we're going to go back to concentrate on, but we will give ourselves continually to prayer and to the ministry of the Word. This isn't because they were mean-spirited or anything. They were prioritizing. What they recognized was the responsibility to feed the church. Without the church getting fed, the growth isn't going to take place that's needed to. So what they had to do, they had to put things in order. They still got to solve the problems. They can't ignore that. That's not possible either. So, and it's pulling their time. So again, and no doubt from the Holy Spirit, they get the wisdom of God in how to solve this. Thus, the position of the deacon arises. All right. It was born out of that need when problems arise. And it's amazing how the Lord does use problems many times to give clear direction, to give insight. Listen, this is what we're going to do to get what he wants. And so, anyhow, let me go on here. And again, I wonder how many today, and you think about it today in ministry, how many today of pastors across our country, across this world, where the bulk of their time is taken up with administration, is taken up with firefighting, if you will, in the church, that's where they end up concentrating the majority of their efforts. I talked with a pastor it was in 2016. Can't remember where I was at. I remember I'm sitting in his office, and he told me this. I couldn't believe it. I was astounded. He said he never gets to study for Sunday morning until late Saturday night. He said, that's when I first, he has a Christian school, all this going on. And I thought, oh my goodness, shut your school down. Shut your school down. He never gets to open his Bible to study, to prepare his primary responsibility in feeding the people the Word of God, and he can't even get to it until late Saturday night, week in and week out. And I'm sure he's not alone in that. I'm sure other responsibilities, that's what was coming up with the apostles here. Other things were popping up, and they realized, we got to change gears here. We got to change gears. And so, again, they provided, the apostles provided the leadership that was needed and came up with the guidance through the Holy Spirit in order to solve this. So they come up with their solution. The solution is in verse 3 and 4. Wherefore, brethren, look out among you seven men of honest report, full of the Holy Ghost and wisdom, whom we may appoint over this business. But we will give ourselves continually to prayer and to the ministry of the word. So, here's their solution. The church, in this case, was to decide upon seven men who will serve. The word deacon basically means one who serves. That's what it means. It means you're to be a servant here in the church. That's your primary responsibility, is to be a servant here in the church. When you begin to lose that mentality, something's wrong. Something's wrong. You're a servant in the church. A deacon's primary responsibility is to serve the church. And then what he broke it down to, the apostles said, listen, now, here's who you're going to look for. And he gave out some qualifications. The first one that he said there is men of honest report. These are to be good men. These are to be men with good reputation before the church. And again, from Brother McDonald and Brother Jacobs, it's your responsibility to maintain an honest report before this church, to maintain your testimony, to be that good man before this church, to serve the church. It doesn't mean you have to be perfect, but it certainly does mean that your walk with God has to be real. It has to be real. It has to be right. Now, along this idea, let's turn on over to 1 Timothy chapter 3 now. Let's go over to 1 Timothy chapter 3. And picking up in verse 8, it gets into qualifications here in the pastoral epistles for that of the position of a deacon. And again, Brother McDonald and Brother Jacobs, these are things you two need to take serious. As you look through this, this is your biblical instructions of the manner of life you need to maintain. It says, likewise, must the deacons be grave. A seriousness, sober-minded when it comes to things of the church, not taking it lightly. The church is it's not a joke. This is the institution that God has given for the perfecting of the saints. I mean, we're responsible for, from world missions to local missions, this is us. It's not a little social club that's to take place. We're to be sober-minded when it comes to this, to be grave, not double-tongued. That means you don't try and come to tell a pastor one thing and another group of people something else. That means you don't do that with people in the church as well. Not given to much wine. Of course, no alcohol. Obviously not a drunkard or anything like that. That becomes a controlling influence in the life. And as we see throughout the Bible, the importance of completely abstaining from alcohol. Not greedy of filthy lucre. And, of course, it can't be a covetous person, a person who's consumed with money and with things. That would never be able to provide good counsel. 9, holding the mystery of the faith in pure conscience. And mystery of the faith is referring to the gospel itself of what we have in Christ. And knowing that you're faithful to that, not only in your witness to it, but in your walk and your thankfulness before what God has done for you. Your seriousness when it does come to the gospel. And let these first be proved. It's not to be a novice. It's not to be somebody that is, you know, is saved one week and a deacon the next. Somebody who has proven their faithfulness in serving the Lord. Then let them use the office. Where am I? Yeah. And let them use the office of a deacon being found blameless. again, going right, same thing with the idea of an honest report and the testimony before the church. Even so must their wives. Now it goes right into the family, of course. Must be grave, not slanderers, sober, faithful in all things. The wives as well have a responsibility. Your family has a responsibility. It is a leadership position within the church. And therefore, everybody's, it's not just you. It's from the wife and from the children. And obviously that's true of the pastor as well. And it's not that your children have to be perfect. They don't. But they have to be led by a godly dad. They have to be led by a godly mom who's providing the instruction, who's following the biblical principles in rearing their children. Let's continue on down here. Let the deacons be the husbands of one wife, ruling their children and their own houses well. And of course, neither of these men have a divorce or anything like that in their background. The importance, again, we do see the importance of marriage before God right here. And in the leadership positions of the church, it's a requirement. And again, that you're rearing your children right. For they that have used the office of a deacon well, purchase to themselves a good degree and great boldness in faith, which is in Christ Jesus. Again, it's taken a significant amount of time to delegate how your honest report is to look before this church. You're representative of it. You know, people will recognize you as leadership in this church. And, you know, we've heard the saying, I believe it was Lee Robertson who would say it over and over, everything rises and falls on leadership. And there certainly is an amount of truth to that. And if our leadership is down here, it's very unlikely that those fallen are going to be above that. All right? If the leadership is maintaining those biblical standards, then the church is going to come behind that. So, he told them, look out those men that have honest report. But that wasn't all. He goes on to say, full of the Holy Ghost. Men who are yielded to the Spirit of God and not the lust of the flesh. In other words, as we see throughout the Word of God, your character matters before God. And if you're to be successful in this role, and the Lord can use you here at the Independent Baptist Church of Anchorage as a deacon, being filled with the Spirit is a must and it is key. You have to yield yourself to Him. And it's just not, as we see in Scripture, it's not just a one-time thing. It's a daily surrender to the Lord. Being faithful with your life so that you can be filled with the Spirit of God. True to your devotions each and every day. Not playing a game with those, but staying faithful to the devotions. Again, so you're in a position that you can be controlled by the Spirit of God. You don't know what's going to come up each and every day. You don't know when your phone's going to ring and what situation the church is facing. And without being filled with the Spirit, we're in trouble. All right? So it needs to be filled with the Spirit, true to the preaching of the Word of God, and not taking the services here lightly that you sit in, you know, Sunday morning, Sunday night, and Wednesday night. Staying true to that. Again, this is all helping you to be in a position so that you can be filled with the Spirit of God. And please don't follow the nonsense, you know, of being, and of course, this is a Baptist church, we're not there today, but I was thinking of a conversation I had earlier today, where, you know, being filled with the Spirit doesn't mean you're going to be jumping around and speaking in tongues and flipping around everywhere. That's a bunch of nonsense. You're going to have wisdom from God that you need. You're going to have boldness when it comes to the faith of the Lord Jesus Christ. As well as removing things from your life that would hinder you from being filled with the Spirit of God. And again, making sure you're in a place where God's Spirit can use you. This way, when problems do come up that the church is facing, and all of a sudden, I've got to give you a call or call you in and say, wow, we've got a fire here. We need some men who are full of the Holy Ghost that can provide the wisdom, which is the next thing that's needed. Because the wisdom is going to come from the Lord, and it specifically brings that up next as the last qualification there. It was honest, men of honest report, men full of the Holy Ghost, and men of wisdom. Now, this doesn't mean it's amazing. I've sat through some of the courses I remember about when you're selecting a deacon of who to look for. One of the things was you find a great businessman. Wise in financial matters. That's not what this wisdom is dealing with. It's not. It's not dealing with that. The key for the success of this church is not having somebody wise in financial matters that can do it. It's somebody who is humbled and yielded to God, who has wisdom from Him. That's what it's about. Being in a deacon, you'll be in a position to help solve problems. And the reality is, you're in a position to either make things worse or make things better, being a deacon. You can either make things much worse or better. You're either going to throw gasoline on a fire or water on a fire, being a deacon in the church, one or the other. And again, once the church found these men, the apostles stressed, now we are going to concentrate on the word of God and prayer. And then the church selected at that point Stephen, Philip, Prochorus, I can't even say the next guy's name, Nicanor, Timon, Parmenas, Nicholas. Now, what's interesting about all these men that I found very interesting is they're all Greek names. They're all Greek names. And so when they looked out, the seven among them, they all chose from the Hellenistic side to be the leader. I just found that interesting. I don't know exactly where to go with all that, but I found that interesting nonetheless. Anyhow, so it mentions, we only know a few things about a few of these deacons. Of course, Stephen is no doubt the most well-known, a man of great faith. He becomes the very first martyr for the faith. And he was just an incredible man. His faith was evident. I'm sure because he was mentioned first, everybody knew right away. Well, we know one guy this is going to be, and that's going to be Stephen. And then we had Philip, who becomes the evangelist. We can almost look at him almost as one of the very first missionaries that the church ever had would be Philip. And so another man who's one of these deacons that plays a significant role. And then we only know something really about one more of these fellows, and that's the very next one. Prochorus, he is said to have become John, the Apostle John's secretary, and then he pastored a church in Nicomedia. And the rest we know nothing of. The rest we don't know anything of, and I think that's kind of significant as well. You know, it's not, again, we talked about this on Sunday night's message when we were looking at all the people that were coming to David, the distressed, you know, those in debt, and it's, you know, I have no doubt that every single one of those seven, you know, would be staying faithful to the Lord, be rewarded greatly. It's not about the name or the recognition, all right? It's not about anything of that sort. So the church had selected these different men, and then what we begin to see is what took place as soon as this got set and was in order. As soon as they did this, you see the importance of the decision. One, it tells us, and because of the results of this, we see they selected the right people. They had the right people in place. Because what they did worked. Look back in Acts chapter 6. As a result of the actions that was taken by the church there at Jerusalem, We see what happened. And we're going to follow verse 6 and we conclude the service tonight. Whom they set before the apostles, and when they had prayed, they laid their hands on them. And we're going to follow that tonight after I finish preaching. But verse 7 there says, "And the word of God increased, and the number of the disciples multiplied in Jerusalem greatly, and a great company of priests were obedient to the faith." Again, this is all the same thought. This is how the Lord blessed after this was in place. After this thing, we see things begin to take off. We see that the Word of God was increased. Now the Word of God has free course, as it's put in the book of 1 Thessalonians. It had free course to work on the hearts. The apostles could apply themselves as they should. Again, when this takes place, things happen. And we certainly need the Word of God to increase, to have that free course, to increase an opportunity from the gospel going out to the preaching services that are here, to increase an understanding of the Word of God, to increase an application of the Word of God, to have these things begin to take place. Because really, this is what changes your life. And I think everyone here would agree with me, we're losing that. Again, the idea now is to set up more of an entertainment package for the people. Don't get me wrong, that's going to make them feel really good when they come in here and sit down. But it's not going to change their life. That nice song that makes them feel good, and they're like, oh, I can just feel the revival spirit. Do you know when they're sitting down at their computer and nobody else is around? They're going to have no strength. Have no strength. They can go in and feel good at a concert. But that's not what this is about. Do you ever notice how it stresses the Word of God over and over and over and over and over from Genesis to Revelation? Because that's where the results come from. That's where they come from. So what the apostles were doing here, and they used the office of a deacon to assist in this, was ensuring the Word of God could increase. That was the key. Ensuring the Word of God could increase. So the proper attention could be placed on it. And results occur. Not only that, the church began to grow. I mean, they're already growing. But now, now it's using multiplication type stuff here. More and more people are now coming to know the Lord. One, you had the church now is, they've solved a major issue in the church. Unity is back in the church. The Word of God is having free course. The people are taking it out to others. They're taking it out to others. The results of the increase was not simply the work of the apostles. That would not be possible. It was the people in the church. It was the people in the church. Because now what was taking place is, as James would get up and preach, the Word of God was increasing. The people are hearing it. It's changing their life. They're heading out. They're heading out and telling others. And now, what was happening before the deacons were in place is, and that's one of the things here, we're going to be instituting something, and I'll be meeting with you men shortly, probably after the trip to New Guinea, of another thing we're going to be instituting to help prevent this, one of the things I believe is happening right here, and that is people falling through the cracks. People falling through the cracks. Basically, they stopped that. All right? They had this thing taking place with the widows, and they realized, we got a problem here. We got a problem here. We got to have a solution so this isn't happening, so we don't have people falling through the cracks. We got to have things in place. They recognize the responsibility to shepherd all of them. And there'll be more to come on that in March. And not only that, what I think is neat here is that the priests of the temple were coming to know the Lord. They were seeing conversions of a very tough group that were putting their faith in Christ. This is referring to the Levites. This is referring to those who had responsibility in the temple. And again, it's not coincidence where this is. It's putting it here, telling us, look, as a result of putting this thing in order, look what takes place. And the priest, I'm sure the priest had questions. I mean, these are the same guys, by the way, that went there when Christ died on the cross and that veil was torn in half. That had to give them great pause. That had to give them great pause. But now, with the Word of God increased, they're converting. They're converting. Even some of those people you didn't think were possible start to come to know the Lord. Why? The Word of God increased. It increased. It was bathed in prayer. And it did its job. It had free course. And so that's part of the responsibility with the deacons, men that are be of honest report, full of the Holy Ghost and wisdom, that can come in and help. And part of the role, again, is going to be helping putting out fires, getting some wisdom together and say, all right, how do we do this? Having things in place so people are not falling through the cracks. And then the example that you live and your family lives before this church, that's going to encourage others and help them as they look to you for guidance and leadership just by the way that you live. The position you have is an awesome one. That should never be forgotten. It's not just about a little committee to vote on things. It's about the people of the church. It's about ensuring that priorities are in order, so that the Word of God can increase and see the growth of the people, see more come to know the Lord, and see lives changed. If we don't have a biblical pattern in order, we will not make a difference in Anchorage, Alaska. Won't happen. But if we do, it's amazing to see what the Lord can do when His Word with His Spirit has free course. Now tonight we're going to go into a short invitation time. Then after that I'm going to have Brother McDonald and Brother Jacobs come up front. I'm going to have the ministry heads also come up at that time. But we're going to go into a short invitation. Now listen, I want to bring this up real quick. Maybe you've been attending church here, maybe you're a visitor. But listen, this message, of course, was for the Independent Baptist Church of Anchorage tonight. But I would be so remiss if I did not bring up the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Listen, please understand this. Maybe you're here tonight and you're not even sure what the gospel is, or you don't know what would happen to you if you were to die right now. Listen, please understand this. The moment death occurs, your soul will depart your body, and it's either going to heaven or hell immediately. No commercials, no stopping points, one or the other. And the answer as to where it goes has everything to do with Jesus Christ, not this church. Not whether you've been baptized, not whether you've turned over a new leaf. It has everything to do with Jesus Christ. He is the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by him. He came to this earth literally to die for you. See, what do you mean by that? He died 2,000 years ago. What he did that day was he took your place in a judgment that is yet to come. He took your place in judgment. And then he gives you his righteousness. See, I don't get all that. Trying to say this, one day you're going to die, you're going to stand before God, and you're guilty. You've broken his law. And the penalty is the lake of fire. But what Jesus did was he took your place at that judgment so that when you stand at that judgment, it looks like you lived the life that Christ lived. Perfect. Perfect. And all it takes is repentance and faith in Jesus Christ, and he will save you from that judgment, and you'll become his right then and there. With heads bowed and eyes closed. Heads bowed and eyes closed. Mm-hmm.